coming out. We're all here because either we know David Winters or we know of David Winters. He's beyond a Hollywood icon. He was a dancer extraordinaire. This was him, probably in one of his, many of his heydays. And I wore red, I'm speaking off the cuff. So I wore red because it's his favorite color. So many of us are hopefully gonna speak, and you're welcome to after we do a little program. I'm going to introduce Donna Waterman, who was the closest to David. I was even there, he wanted to marry her. And she's very emotional, and she's gonna read a couple of poems that she wrote. And I hope she can keep it together, you know, because she's very emotional. And after that, we're gonna roll some tape of his incredible performance reels.
Yeah.
That'll just blow us away. He's worked with the best. Let's just say a couple of them. Donna Summer, Elvis Presley, and Margaret, Mike. He just shouted out, he's worked with them. And
Darren.
There you go, Bobby Darin was his friend. I mean, he even did the Splish Splash. He even told him about that, Paul Newman. And regarding the Splish Splash, if you, oh, by the way, David wrote a book, an autobiography, and it's called Tough Man Can Dance. Tough Guys Can Dance. Tough Guys Do Dance. Sorry, you can get it on Amazon. It doesn't cost that much, but I'll tell you, it takes you through a journey of his life. I mean, from growing up in Brooklyn to the heights of Monaco with Princess Grace and hanging out with Anne Margaret and Barbara Streisand. I mean, it's just incredible. I do suggest you get the book if you have any extra shekels on you. Anyway, I'm going to turn this over to Donna. And here's Donna going to read some poems that she wrote for David. And then we're going to have fun.
Hi, thank you for being here. His next door neighbor, Tori, he had sent me a condolence card, and it sort of summed up what David was about. It said, some people don't just live life, they illuminate it. And that's what David did. He illuminated life. I have some notes here, like I like to read also before I read the poetry, and I hope this is not, attach that. David was a face of mobile character. He had childlike eyes, pouting lips. He was actually a quiet master. Winters was like a magnet, drawing everything in with deep emotion. He always admitted as being a gypsy. He couldn't sit still. He always had to travel. He spent over 20 years in Bangkok. And then he started coming back when he did the movie Dancing It's On, which he filmed in Florida, in Panama City. And then he stayed here. And then he left, went back to Bangkok, and then he came back the following year. And I was his constant companion for those 3.5 years. David's aura in later years was quiet simplicity of life, and yet he had that turmoil of being highly emotional. He was a chameleon, a genius of sorts. When near him, you felt every vibration. He was moody, broody, guarded. His likeness when I first met him was like, almost like Truman Capote. He was alone in his thoughts until. David came back to South Florida about 6.5 months ago, and I was with him every day. He was my fiance, and I loved him dearly. On his birthday, April 5th, I gave him a book of poetry that I started writing when I first met him almost 3.5 years ago. And as Laurel said, I would like to read some of those poems to you. I shudder to think of you not here by my side, making your voice heard far and wide, rising to the occasion with applause in your heart, directing with firm hand the role your part. Another one was, I can't live without you. I can't live without you, but knowing I must, My heart imagines to go with my trust of loving you forever. You're my life, you're my music, you're my heart. You're my every breath I breathe. You're the mystery in me of which I seek to need. You are my memories, the joy I feel. In my imagination, I feel it's real. And the last one that I read to him, because he had me read the whole book to him, which is over 25 poems. As you lie there, I watch you breath by breath, drinking in the warmth of memories. The moments blend into minutes and hours, recreating a life so cherished with emotion. The dance continues through closed eyes that now open wide. The fingers tap to the rhythm. A smile settles in to the grandeur of your style. Yes, David Winters was bigger than life, and I'm going to miss him forever. Thank you. And we're going to see a few scenes of video. We can play it now. Thank you. Thank you.
Getting older, I'm thinking to myself, what really makes me happy in life? And what really makes me happy is dancing. And I've always said in any interview I've ever given that no matter what I may achieve in my life, I will always just be a dancer.
Holy smokes, that's David Winters. I mean, I just want a pirouette for him. Anyway, you have to get his book, because every single person that you saw him work with and more is in that book, chock full of juicy details, titillating things, ear-bending things. So I'm going now to introduce Paul Levine. He is the owner of Famous Faces, talent agency, and SAG-AFTRA franchised. I'm one of his talents, by the way. Here comes Paul. He has a long history of movie greats, and I'm gonna let him talk more about that. Hi, Paul.
Good morning. Still morning, yes it is. Wow, tough act to follow, right? David, I mean, when they made David, they threw the mold away. I mean, this guy, for the last year, he spent more time in my office than I did. But he was asking questions. We had some plans. So I want to tell you just a couple of things. I won't be too long. Back in 2015, the Actors Playhouse in Coral Gables presented West Side Story. I took David to the opening night, and boy, was it a gala. They turned it into an after party with 750 first-nighters. They couldn't get enough of David. And David was smiles and smiles, and he kept saying, this is it, this is it. I says, yes. Now, in April of 2019, just recently, the Mall's Jupiter Theater, which used to be the old Burt Reynolds Dinner Theater up in Jupiter, did their version of West Side Story, and I was going to take David to see it. However, day by day, in every way, David got worse and never got to see it. I wound up going by myself on the last showing on a Sunday matinee and thinking about David. We at Famous Faces had some really good future plans for David. He couldn't wait to get started. I made a suggestion of doing a tour at the condominiums and colleges as a motivational speaker. And he just, when are we gonna do it? I said, David, when you get better. He never got better, and we never pursued that. However, I sincerely hope that, I'm a little bit choked up here. Okay, I sincerely hope that we will be able to, at some period of time, do either a Broadway play or a major motion picture. I'm sure I can get a lot of people interested in investing in it. And that's, I hope that will become a reality. Pardon me? Of his life. Yes, of course. Okay. You know, I've never seen such an incredible resume that comes close to David's. When you count, and I went through a lot of pictures and things that he's done, I stopped at 160, and there are more. I realized that the accomplishments that David has done, it would take at least 5 lifetimes. David Winters did it in one. Now, I also have, what is a special friend? A special friend is hard to find, hard to lose, and impossible to forget. You meet people who sometimes forget you, and sometimes you forget people you meet. But sometimes you meet those people you can't forget. Those are your special friends. David was my friend. The loss of a real friend is like that of losing a limb. Time may heal the anguish of the wound, but the loss cannot be repaired. You know, we all lose friends, good ones and special ones. We lose them in death, in distance, and over time. But even though they may be lost, hope is not. The key is to keep them in your heart. When a special friend unexpectedly leaves us, a piece of our heart is broken forever. When a special friend like David Winters becomes a memory, that memory becomes a lasting treasure forever. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. As David would say all the time, boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Is there anybody else who would like to say a few words about David? I know, Darren, please come up. Darren Vega, he's come from Mobile, Alabama, and he worked with David on Dancing with Dawn. And Robert, I'd love for you to come up because you grew up with David. Hold on, here's Darren.
Hey, welcome, everybody. I think we all have a special place in our hearts for David. I've known him for about 10 years, and the 10 years that I've known him, that's really dwarfed by some of the relationships that he's had and the long list of friendships that he's had for over 30, 40, 50 years. So I feel really that it's a privilege to know David. I didn't really prepare anything today. I didn't really want to. I just figured it would kind of flow. We had a few things in common, David and I. We shared a birthday, April 5th. I was 1977, so he was a little bit older. But even though he was a lot older, we became dear friends. And during the movie Dancing, It's On, I would go and stay with him. We'd stay up all night like kids watching YouTube videos of him with, you know, everybody that you could think of. But there was a few things that really touched him. And you know, I think that it's definitely worth mentioning that David was an extreme person, extremely kind, extremely loving, and he showed you the good, bad, and the ugly, really. And that's refreshing sometimes. I know that there was a few messages that I got where I'd say, David, you can't say that. There's something that I'm not even going to say, but being raised in England, you know, there's this word that uses the C word occasionally, and I'd say, David, you can't say that, man. And he's like, I can say anything. You know, that's just how he was. And that's the thing about David is he was uncompromising. It had to be his way, and that really was reflected in his body of work. For somebody to be dear friends with Elvis Presley, he told me a story one time. You know, David never did drugs or drank. He was completely against that, okay? But he told me a story one time. He was in the car with a bunch of other people, and they got pulled over, and they were all hauled into jail because there was, I guess there was a little bit of weed in the car, right? So David's sitting there in jail, and he thinks to himself, who do I need to call to bail me out, right? So the first person that came to his mind was Liza Minnelli. That's his best friend, right? So he calls Liza and says, hey, I was wondering if you could bail me out. So she calls the jail to bail David out, and she calls back and says, David, your bail's been made. And he says, really, who did it? Who bailed me out? And she says, Elvis Presley. So those are the types of stories that you could just sit there for hours and listen to. Or Barbara Streisand calling him and saying, David, can you come over? I have this new song I want to show you, and there's some moves. Can you come over? So he'd sit in her living room, actually, as she would perform live, a live performance, just her and David. You know, so I think about how he affected even how we know movies today. I was a little kid in Los Angeles, okay, in the 80s. And I was a breakdancer. I was pretty good. I took, you know, first place trophies all over Los Angeles, right? You know what my favorite movie was? Break-In. Do you know who discovered Shabadoo that was in Break-In? David Winters. On Hullabaloo. If you know that old show. Hullabaloo would showcase Shabadoo. Shabadoo was an excellent dancer, and even prior to the whole breakdancing movement, Shabadoo would come out with some really slick moves. Moves that were actually, even the moonwalk, David said, that wasn't Michael Jackson's. You know, that was before Michael Jackson, and that's another person that was very dear to David's heart, is Michael Jackson. You know, they did a tour together. He went with them. And he said that Michael was so kind that behind the scenes, he was donating millions of dollars to children's hospitals all the time, just donating money, and that he was a very gentle and tender man. So he had a side of him that was extremely lovable. He had an ugly side too, but the good was so good that you kind of tended to overlook the bad. And you even developed a respect for the way that he lived his life, and that was his way. And he certainly is an icon, I think, in every sense of the word. You know, I look at the old monkey shows, if you guys ever saw the monkeys. Yeah. Do you know who was responsible for all the greatness of the monkeys? David Winters. And there's a lot of things that really he didn't get credit for. If you watch Viva Las Vegas, that whole skit with Elvis and Anne Margaret putting one foot in front of the other, that's David Winters. David Winters is in that scene. It's a very small role. You know, he would always point it out to me when we were watching TV together. He'd say, that's me right there. It was just a split second. I don't even know if you could call it a cameo, right? I think the camera guy just kind of accidentally got him in it. But for him to have so many friends, and you know, for you guys to be here today, I think would be so meaningful to him. The turnout in Los Angeles was really nice as well. I wish I could have gone. It was out of my control that I couldn't be there. I have a 4-year-old and I have a family. David and I, we met on a movie set, and we just kind of immediately started getting to know each other and became really dear friends. So he asked me to sit on the set next to him in the director's seat, they always had a seat for me. You know, so I was the one going to the barber and we were brainstorming ideas. My ex-wife was an extra on Dancing It's on that movie. And that marriage didn't work out, and I was always say, hey, you're responsible. You know, the original name of Dancing It's On was East Side Story. And the name changed to Dancing It's On later on. I don't know exactly the reason, but I would always tell him, do you want to know the real East Side Story, you son of a bitch? You ruined my marriage. You know, I would always give him heck about that because she actually met someone on the set of his movie. But just all the stories, I'm trying to recall, you know, the stories. He worked with so many people. Paul Newman, he's got pictures. He told me they bought race cars together. And I don't know if you saw the picture where he had a big fur coat on and a cowboy hat. The guy was really outlandish. He was really, and I say that in the best way. He was certainly a showman, right? And I feel privileged to know him. And Donna has a very deep love for him. And I know she would have loved to had his hand in marriage. And she was his caregiver. She was the person right by his side the whole time. So really this whole thing is a tribute to David, but I really believe that this is a tribute also to Donna. Yeah. And I said that we shared a lot of things. We share a birthday. He probably wanted to share my ex-wife, but this is his shirt. You can see how loud he was, right? I love it though. He was always. It's not a tie. No, this is his shirt. And Donna was kind enough to give me all of his silk custom-made shirts that I want to continue to wear. And I stayed at his place last night. That was hard. It was really hard staying at his place. You know. It's difficult, you know, when you lose someone you really care about. He was the guy that I always called to vent to. And I don't have that with anybody else. You know, I'm always the guy that wears a smile, but with David, I would just let him stand. And he would too. He'd call me and say, hey, babes, call me, you know. And I know you saved some messages too, didn't you? I got one save left. I erased the one that had the C word all in it, you know. But what a wonderful man. And so I guess I'm here to say, David, keep dancing.
Yeah. I'm just going to give my 2 cents and then, Robert, I'd love you to come. Actually, go. Come. I'll give my 2 cents later. I'll turn into 3.
My name is Robert Padgett. Some of you might know me, we might have worked together. David and I grew up, we were child actors together. He went into dancing, I went into trying to figure out what Lee Strasberg said. When we were in New York, we were just like a whole bunch of other kids running around, you know. In those days, you didn't really have to go anywhere with your parents. He was a free floater, I was a free floater. He'd work television shows, I'd work television shows. Eventually, he was doing Broadway, I was doing more live television. And he was always the same, even as a child. I've never heard David raise his voice. This man would listen to people argue and argue and argue, and he would just sit there very complacently, take it all in, and then work it all out. Over a period of years, I've seen him in London, I've seen him in Cannes, France, I've seen him in Rome, and we've worked together again. In France, when I was directing movies in Rome, I was in Cannes on a film, and he was there doing the film with Carol Monroe. I can't remember the name. Does anyone remember the name? No, I can't remember. It was on the top of my mind, but senior moments are creeping in here quite a bit. But I was in the Croisette, and he came walking by, and he said, I'm doing a movie here. I need an actor. Robert, you're going to be in it. I said, okay, let me know. 2 weeks later, I'm back at home in London. I get a phone call. It's David. He says, I'm here in London shooting the movie. Come and help me. So I worked on that movie for him. I saw him all the time over there. He was always putting things together. He was always helping people. He really was very generous. I came back to the United States. I got a call out of the blue somehow. We teamed up. I was in Florida. He calls me, he says, I'm doing a film called East Side Story. I'm looking for locations. Can you help me? And I said, you can do here in Miami. They got a lot of places. They got great dances and everything. We talked and talked and talked. He couldn't put it together here for some reason or other. So he went to Panama City, I think, as you said, and he put it together there. And we kept in touch by phone call, by texting. And then a few years went by, and I didn't see him. He was in Bangkok. I didn't go to Bangkok. He called me up a couple of times. He says, come out here. You'd have a great time. I never did. And then I bumped into him again just before he got very, very ill. And he told me about getting this new agent. And I wished him luck. And I didn't see him for a while. And then about 6 months ago, was it, Donna? The SAG Awards, not too long ago, I'm there, and I get a tap on my shoulder from Donna, and Donna says, there's a friend of yours here. There's David. That's the last time we saw each other. We had some pictures taken. We spoke. We spoke on the phone a couple of times. I found out he was getting very, very ill. I sent my good wishes through Donna. I never got to see him in the hospital. Except once, and then when I was going to visit him the last time, Donna called me up and said, I have to go see him that day. I couldn't do it. I had things to do. But when he went, I felt very, very sad. I've known David, I think, I can honestly say over 70 years. I'm 83. He's 81, I think, or 80. So we go back a long time. Even on the West Side Story set, I was there, I auditioned for the movie, I never made it, but I was on the set all the time. I saw David, I knew he was living, where he was living, they were all living together, all these dancers, all these New York dancers. We were all friends. David was always there for everybody. I will miss him. I have pictures of him going back years, and I will keep him in my heart for as long as I live. Thank you very, very much.
I just want to tell you my experience with David Winters, and anybody else who would like to come up also. I met David, I actually presented him the Best Director Award, I think it was for Dancing It's On, at the first annual White Screen Film Festival, and I didn't know who he was at the time. So I'm just handing this lovely man an award, and then who would know it? That's David Winters. Oh my God. So I don't remember how this happened, but months went by, and then we were talking on the phone. I don't know how that happened. And then I ended up coming to his home in Fort Lauderdale, and we wanted to work on a project. We were talking about making a film. Because I was an actress, and he wanted to do something, and when he answered the door, now I'm remembering this. When he answered the door, he was wearing a black silk long shirt with his red slippers, and he says, I think he's something like, I don't wear underwear. Something like that. That's exactly what he said. He was eccentric. He was amazing. And he was like, he's so childlike. He was amazing. And so we went to go sit in front of his big Mac screen computer, and we were starting to just look at things that he's done so I can feel who he is. And I didn't realize still at the time the magnitude of who I'm with, you know, and we're talking. And so I left, and nothing really panned out of that. He was getting very busy. He was just a busy man. And then Donna, which I thought I introduced Donna, but apparently I didn't. Pierce, may he rest in peace also. I'm trying to think, so there was times with David, I was just talking on the phone with him when he was in Thailand, not feeling well. My husband is a cardiologist, and so they were conferring back and forth, and he was worried. So when he came back to Florida, I thank God had an opportunity to meet with David a week before he passed, and I went to their home, where you're staying now, and I brought my dancing shoes, and I wanted him to sign my Capizio dancing shoes, and he did, and I have them, and I wanted to bring them. I just, they're like a huge souvenir and memento for that. He also signed at the SAG Awards. I brought my book, the book that I was telling you about that he wrote. He signed it for me as well. It's just dear to my heart. His mother had a birthday, April 15th. When did David pass?
April
23rd. So I know his mother had a birthday, April 15th, because that's the day my grandson was born. And then when I said, oh, David, I'm not sure, it was like he... My grandson was born on his mother's birthday, which happens to be my mother's birthday. So that was kind of cool. Anyway, so when I heard of that he was just deteriorating and just not doing well, it was just like a big flower is losing his petals. And but he was so strong to the end, and he was so soft-spoken. When you heard him speak, it's like, you have to listen in. It's like, you know, because he was so soft-spoken, you kind of just leaned forward. Wasn't loud whatsoever that I knew of. I guess you guys all have other stories somehow. Anyway, I'm done with my story. Does anybody else have anything to share about David, something at all? And if not, we're going to roll tape on something else about David's life. Oh, Sarah?
Don't forget about photograph.
The photograph. Oh, at the end of our memorial tribute life celebration, we're going to take a group photo out in front of that, the banner. So, cameraman or projection man, could you please roll the next wonderful tape about David? Thank you.
Thank you.
Diana Ross, Frank Sinatra, Elvis, Cher, the list goes on and on. Now, dancer and choreographer David Winters is here in Vegas sharing some of his favorite stories from classic films like Viva Las Vegas and West Side Story, a movie that he says shows tough guys do dance. The famous scene from West Side Story featuring one of the most acclaimed actors, dancers, choreographers, David Winters. How are you?
Fine, thank you. Nice to be here.
Nice to have you. You're in Vegas because you've got this book called Tough Guys Do Dance.
Yep.
And it shares all of the stories you have about working on, you know, West Side Story or working with that guy, Elvis Presley and Anne Margaret.
And it's a number one Amazon bestseller.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Now, we obviously know the famous moves and the hip shaking. Yeah. Was he just a naturally gifted dancer?
Well, he's not a dancer. He moves very, very well. So I had to kind of make everything work for him. So I've done that with a lot of people I've had to work with, whether it's Lucille Ball or Sonny and Cher or whoever it is.
Is it exciting for you, having worked with Sonny and Cher back in the day, knowing that Cher still has the successful show in Vegas?
Isn't that great?
That she's still just going and just...
Incredible.
Right?
Incredible, yeah.
You worked with some of the other biggest names out there, Diana Ross, Michael Jackson, choreographed a special for them, both in at the same time, right?
Went on the set and Michael was there and she said, David, this is Michael, Michael, this is David. And Michael said, oh, I already know David. And I said, Michael, I don't think so. If I had met Michael Jackson in my life, I would remember.
Right?
For sure. So he got real close to me and he put up his finger like this and he went like this. West Side Story.
Oh, wow.
So I
knew.
And we clicked. And I'm hoping, one of the reasons if my book is, I'm hoping that more boys go to dance class.
Yes.
They're not afraid to go to ballet class, you know? But let's get more boys. Let's get more boys in the dance class. Come on.
Absolutely.
Get out there and show them you're tough.
No, listen, and first of all, ladies love a guy who can dance, so it's really a smart thing to do.
Well, it is. I tell you, I used to take 10 hours a day, 6 days a week dance class, and then I went to the disco, and I danced for another 2 hours, and I picked up more girls. I didn't have to say or do anything. I just got up on the dance floor, and I danced my heart out.
And you had no problem.
None whatsoever. It was great.
See, who needs Tinder or Match.com if you can just dance, right? And you can meet the very delightful David Winters. Has so many stories. He talked about working with Barbra Streisand on A Star Is Born. He's so excited to see Lady Gaga take on that signature role. Lots of stories to share. He's going to have a special book signing at the Red Rock tomorrow from 12:30 to 4:30. And again on Thursday from 9 until noon. I really encourage you to check it out. Just a sweet guy, and his resume is impressive. Well,
And to conclude our tribute is a wonderful singer we have here with us. Her name is Amy Barbera. And what is the name of the song you're singing? It's Somewhere. And she'll intro it. Amy Barbera, please. She's lovely.
Oh, I can't believe I'm here. And I'm going to be singing for this icon. And I'm just this little thing. This is probably the most nervous I've ever been. And an honor to be able to sing. But I want to share a couple of things because I got to know David at the very end of his life and got to spend time with him in the hospital. And we had this thing with string cheese, right, Donna? Every day he'd come to the office at Famous Faces and I'd bring him cheese. And then he'd ask Donna, where's Amy's cheese? So we would always share. I actually was gonna bring everybody string cheese today, but I ended up not bringing the cheese. But anyhow, what I wanna share is about, I went to see him a few days after his birthday in the hospital. And of course I brought him this big bouquet of balloons. And remember, he didn't have any underwear on. And I'm like, I'm behind the curtain. And he said, tell her to come on in. At this point, I don't really care. You know, he's like, oh, I don't care. So I'm sitting there with the balloons in front of my face because, you know, from the shirt down, he's completely naked. But it was the most precious thing. And I just remember sitting there with him and Donna. And at that time of my life, I was just running constantly. And I just felt this peace that surpasses understanding just sitting there with Donna for about an hour, hour and a half. Like, I'm supposed to be here. And it just felt so peaceful to just sit in the quiet and be with David. And he was in so much pain. I would take his hand and I'd say, David, I'm praying for you. And he'd always say, thank you, Amy. Thank you. He didn't ever know what to say when I tell him I was praying, because I'm actually a Christian, so I'd always say, David, can I pray for you? And he would say, you can pray, thank you. You know, he didn't know what to say. And then a few weeks after that, it was probably about a week or so before he passed away, my friend Elisa and I and Donna went to go see him at the hospital, and that was the last time I would ever see him. And of course, Donna was on her way there, she wasn't there, and Elisa was on one side of his bed, and I was on the other side of his bed, and he took my hand. And he was in so much pain, and I was just praying, God, just take his pain away. Because he was just in pain, and I just kept saying, you know, he'd just take his pain away. And he said, you know, Amy, I love my mother so much. He said, and my mother was my everything, and I missed her so much. And I kept saying, David, you're going to see her soon. You're going to be with her in heaven soon. And he says, when my mom was dying, I dropped everything I was doing. He said, all the projects, everything I was doing. He didn't care what he was doing. He said, I left everything. And I came and I spent, I think it was like 3 weeks, right, Donna? 3 weeks by her side. I never left her side. He said, I hugged her. I talked to her. I told her how much she meant to me. And he said, and I didn't care about anything else. I didn't care about, you know, my projects or anything. And he said, and then he says to me, you know, when you get older like me and you're in this state, you just want to be hugged. You know, he said a lot of times when people are like in nursing homes and nobody comes to see them or nobody hugs them. And he said, my message to you, Amy, is we just want to be hugged. And I remember I started crying and crying. And I mean, I didn't know what to say because what do you say? And I gave him a big hug and I held his hand. And of course, about 10 minutes after that, Donna comes in. So I wanted to share that because a lot of people know him in different times of their life. Like I just met him at the end of his life, like Donna met him at the end of his life. But the thing is we can have all these accolades and we can do all these things and have all this success. But David, in that moment, he just wanted to share about the love that he had for his mother and that's all that mattered and that we need love and we need hugs and to be there. So that's the message that I felt like I was supposed to share today. And also, a day after he passed away, I was training my voice because I'm a professional singer. And I was singing somewhere, and I heard David's voice saying, Amy, I want you to sing for my memorial. And I started bawling. And I said, God and David, if you want me to sing, I don't want to ask. I want it to be completely God. I didn't want to push myself. And all of a sudden, I was at work at Famous Faces, and Donna, out of nowhere, it was just me and her in the office, Alan was out, Paul was out. She said, Amy, she comes over to me, she said, I think you're supposed to sing somewhere, right? I feel like, and I about fell out of my chair, because it was between me, God, and David. So today I'm going to sing somewhere in his memory, and I just pray that I'm the best. And when I sing, I want you guys to imagine him dancing, and I just want to be the best for David. I can't even believe I'm standing here in his honor to sing somewhere. Here I go.
Thank you.
information. I really appreciate it, and I know David would appreciate it. Thank you, Laurel. Thank you, Michelle. Thank you, Sabre Theater. Thank you, Paul, Robert, Garrett, everybody who attended today. Thank you very much. And don't forget the group picture outside. Thank you. And Paul, yes, Paul. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming.
I just wanted to say, I want to thank you personally for being here. I got to tell you, we'll leave a little anecdote. That one day, David said, am I a famous face? I said, of course you are. He says, you know, but my feet are more famous than my face. Can you open up a division called Famous Feet? Yeah, it just came back to me. Yeah, he was one of a kind. I wish there was more people here, but you know, the real people are here today. Thank you so much.